Sahanavavato, sahanau bhunakto, sahaviryam karavavahai, tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai. Om shanti shanti shanti. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwarah, Gururev Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Satchidananda Rupaya, Vishwot Patyadi Hetave, Tapatraya Vinashaya Shri Krishnaya Vayam Numaha Nigamakalpataror Galitam Phalam Shukamukhadamrutadravasam Yutam Pibata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam Muhuraho Rasika Bhuvibhavukah Janmadhyasya yatonvayadi tarataha Charteshva bhignyaswarata Tene brahmahrdaya adikavaye Muhyanti yatsurayaha Tejo varimrdam yatha vinimayo Yatratrisargo mrsha Dhamna svena sada nirasta kuhakam satyam param dhimahi dharma projita kaita votra paramo nirmatsaranam satam vedyam vastava matra vastu shivadam tapatra yonmulanam Shrimad Bhagavate Mahamunikrate Kimva Parairishwaraha Sadyo Hridyavarudyate Trakritibhi Sushrushubhistakshanat Sushrushubhistakshanat We are in the fifth chapter of the eighth canto. There were two or three requests which I have been debating for the past 20 minutes and not yet reached to a conclusive answer myself. So let me ask everybody. Today is a very auspicious day. And the way we have marked it is with few extra candle lights. Today is Kartika Shuddha Purnami. And it's supposed to be very auspicious for various spiritual sadhanas. The reason I am giving you this background is, now I will get you to the actual situation. the request that I had was, can we repeat or chant these 28 shlokas so that it will be practiced? Reason 1. So that it could be recorded? Reason 2. So that it can be uploaded? Reason number 3. But then when I chant and you have to repeat, I see one book. So would you be able to chant? Do you want to chant? Yes or no? Okay. We can try repeating. That's a modest answer. First time, you are allowed to. Sri Krishna. So repeat after me. We will keep the tune pretty simple. If you have learnt the tune of Bhagavad Gita, this tune should be easier. It will be same thing like Sarva Dharman Parityadya Mamekam Sharanam Raja Aham Tva Sarva Papebhya Moksha Ishyami Masucha. It will be the same kind of tune. This is in the So this is in the third chapter, the second shloka. Shri Gajendra Vacha. Om Namo Bhagavate Tasmai. Yata Etat Chidatmakam. Purushaya Dibijaya. Pareshayabhidhimahi Yasmin Nidam Yatascedam Yenedam Yayidam Swayam Yosmat Parasmat Chaparam Tam prapadye svayam bhuvam yasvatmani yasvatmanidam nijamayayarpitam yasvatmanidam nijamayayarpitam kvachit vibhatam kvachatattirohitam Kvachit vibhatam kvachatattirohitam avidrag sakshubhayam tadikshate sakshubhayam tadikshate sa atma mulo vatumam parat paraha vatumam parat paraha Kalena panchatvamiteshu krutsnashaha Kalena panchatvamiteshu krutsnashaha Lokeshu paleshu cha sarvahetushu Lokeshu cha sarvahetushu Tamastadasid gahanam gabhiram Tadasid gahanam gabhiram Yastasya pare bhivirajate vibhuhu Yastasya pare bhivirajate vibhuhu Nayasya devarshayah padam viduhu Nayasya devarshayah padam viduhu Jantuh punar korhati gantumiritum Jantuh punah kor hati gantumiritum yatha natasya kriti bhir vicheshtatah yatha natasya kriti bhir vicheshtatah duratyayanukramanas samamavatu didrukshavo yasya padam sumangalam didrukshavo yasya padam sumangalam vimukta sangha munayasu sadhavaha vimukta sangha munayasu sadhavaha charantya lokavratam avranam vane vratam avranam vane bhutatma bhuta suhrdasame gatihi bhutatma bhuta suhrdasame gatihi na vidyate yasya cha janma karma va na vidyate yasya cha janma karma va na nama rupe guna dosha eva va na nama rupe guna dosha eva va tathapi lokapyaya sambhavaya yaha tathapi lokapyaya sambhavaya yaha swamayaya tanyanukalam ichrati swamayaya tanyanukalam ichrati tasmai namah pareshaya brahmane anta ananta shaktaye arupayorurupaya nama aascharya karmane nama atma pradipaya sakshine paramatmane namo giram viduraya manasaschetasamapi sattvena pratilabhyaya naishkarmyena vipaschita namah kaivalyanathaya nirvana sukha samvide namah shantaya ghoraya mudhaya gunadharmine nirvisheshaya samnyaya namo jnana ghanaya cha kshetrajnaya namastubhyam sarvadhyakshaya sakshine purushayatma mulaya mula prakritaye namaha sarvendriya gunadrashtre sarva pratyaya hetave asatachhaya yoktaya yoktaya sadabhasaya te namaha namo namaste khila karanaya nishkaranaya adbhutakaranaya nishkaranaya adbhutakaranaya Sarvagamamnaya Maharnavaya. Amnaya Maharnavaya. Namo Pavargaya Parayanaya. Gunar Gunarani Channa Chidushmapaya. Gunarani Channa Chidushmapaya. Tatkshobha Vispurjita Manasaya. Vispurjita Manasaya. Naishkarmya Bhavena Vivarjitagama. Naishkarmya Bhavena Vivarjitagama. Swayam Prakashaya Namaskaromi. Madhrak Prapanna Pashupasha Vimokshanaya. Madhrak Prapanna Pashupasha Vimokshanaya. Muktaya Bhuri Karunaya Namolayaya. Bhuri Karunaya Namolayaya. Swamshena Sarvatanu Brunmanasi Pratita. Swamshena Sarvatanu Brunmanasi Pratita. Pratyagdrishe Bhagavate Brihate Namaste. Pratyagdrishe Bhagavate Brihate Namaste. Atmatma japta grihi vitta janeshu saktaihi. Atmatma japta griha vitta janeshu saktaihi. Dushprapanaya guna sanga vivarjitaya. Dushprapanaya guna sanga vivarjitaya. Muktatma bhisva hridaye paribhavitaya. Muktatma bhisva hridaye paribhavitaya. Jnanatmane bhagavate nama ishvaraya. Jnanatmane bhagavate nama ishvaraya. Yam dharma kamartha vimukti kamaha. Yam dharma kamartha vimukti kamaha. Bhajanta ishtam. Bhajanta ishtam gatimapnuvanti. Bhajanta ishtam gatimapnuvanti. Kim tvashishoratyapi dehamavyayam. Kim tvashishoratyapi dehamavyayam. Karotu medabhradayo vimokshanam. Karotu medabhradayo vimokshanam. Ekantino yasya na kanchanartham. Ekantino yasya na kanchanartham. Vanchanti yevai bhagavat prapannaha. Vanchanti yevai bhagavat prapannaha. Atyadbhutam tacharitam sumangalam. Charitam sumangalam. Gayanta ananda samruddha samudra magnaha. Gayanta ananda samudra magnaha. Tamaksharam brahma paramparesham. Avyakta madhyatmika yoga gamyam. Yoga gamyam. Atindriyam sukshmami vati duram. Ananta madhyam paripurnamide. Yasya brahmadayo devaha. Veda lokascharacharaha. Nama rupa vibhedena. phalgavya chakalaya krutaha, phalgavya chakalaya krutaha, yatharchishogne saviturgabhastayaha, chishogne saviturgabhastayaha, niryanti sanyanti sakrut svarochishaha, sanyantya sakrut svarochishaha, tathayatoyam gunasampravahaha, tathastyatoyam gunasampravahaha, buddhirmanakhani shira sharira sargaha, buddhirmanakhani sharira sargaha, savaina deva suramartya tiryak, savaina deva suramartya tiryak, nastri nashando napuman najantuhu, nastri nashando napuman najantuhu, nayam gunah karma nasannachasan, nayam gunah karma nasannachasan, nishedhasesho jayatadasesha, tadasesha, jiji vishenahamihamuyakim, vishenahamihamuyakim, antarbahischavrataye bhayonya, antarbahischavrataye bhayonya, ichhamikale nayasya viplavaha, kale nanayasya viplavaha, tasyatma loka varanasya moksham, tasyatma loka varanasya moksham, soham vishvasrujam vishvam, avishvam vishvavedasam, vishvatmanamajam brahma, pranatosmi parampadam, yogarandhita karmanah, hriti yoga vibhavite, yogino yam prapashyanti, yogesham tam natosmyaham, natosmyaham, namo namastubhyam asahya vega, namastubhyam asahya vega, shaktitrayaya khiladhi gunaya, trayaya khiladhi gunaya, prapannapalaya duranta shaktaye, prapannapalaya duranta shaktaye, kadindriyana manavapya vartmane, kadindriyana manavapya vartmane, nayam veda swamatmanam, yachaktyaham dhiyahatam, chaktyaham dhiyahatam, tam duratyayamahatmyam, tyayamahatmyam, bhagavantamitosmyaham, iti Srimad Bhagavate, Mahapurane, Paramahamsyam, Samhitayam, Ashtamaskandhe, Gajendra Mokshane, Tritiyodhyayaha, Gajendra Stutihi Samapta. So this was the 28 shlokas of the famous Gajendra Moksha Stuti. And it so happened that today is the Kartika Purnami, and today we have chanted this. Hopefully you maintain it as a habit so that you also get the same kind of crystal clear clarity. Triple C. So that you get out of confused comparative mind. It always, you know, compares and confuses us. So this Gajendra Stuti should help us retain that clarity at any event of our life which can be overwhelming. So here we proceed further in the fifth chapter, Sri Shuka Uvacha. Now you don't need to repeat, as if, as though. Rajan uditame tatte hare karma karmaghanashanam gajendra mokshanam punyam raivatam tu antaram shrunu. Shukadev ji says to Parikshit Maharaj, hey Rajan, hey Parikshit, this beautiful leela of Gajendra and his moksha, what does it do? Karma agha nashanam. Has a very beautiful definition of sin. What is sin? Usually when we say sin, we define it from the most external peripheral thing, wherein we say that when we do an action, it hurts others at a physical level, mental level, emotional level, at a spiritual level, then that is called sin. Here, they said, anything that you do with ahankara is sin. Such a beautiful definition. What about good, bad, meritorious, non-meritorious, sab bhad mein gaya. One stroke he has covered everything. He says, anything that we do, end up doing with ahankara is a sin. How did I arrive at that kind of a definition here? Karma aghanashanam. Where did it say that karma means anything with ahankara? A simple mathematics. 2 + 3 = 5. Good. At least one person answered. Apna calculator nikalo, bata chalega. 2 + 3 = 5. 5 - what = 2? 3? Very good. Now everybody is in the same page. Simple mathematics, right? Addition and subtraction. Similarly, karya, get this very, very simple step, but you have to understand this. Karya plus karta is equal to karma. I'll explain. Don't get into the, but understand the sutra. Karya plus karta is equal to karma. Karma minus karta is equal to karya. So what did he say here? Karma is equal to agha. And this parayana, this study of Gajendra Moksha, Gajendra Stuti, is nashanam, aghanashanam, removes the sin of karma. Now where is sin in karma? So what is karma is equal to? Karya plus karta is equal to karma. There is an activity being done. The activity, the moment it is claimed as by the owner with the ahankara, it becomes karma. The moment it becomes karma, while we are performing that karma, this ahankara starts getting agitated. Am I doing as I was supposed to do? I go to so many houses. So when they start serving, the first thing, the lady of the house has a disclaimer. What is a disclaimer? That amma says, Swamiji, first disclaimer, serving you, we should not taste it. I don't know how it has ended up. So first disclaimer. So far can be understood. Now the second disclaimer. Usually, I cook very decently. You can ask my family members. They have survived for these many years. Usually, I am a good cook. I do a decent job. But I don't know, today, I was so nervous, I was so anxious as to how it would come. I think I definitely have spoiled the terms that I have prepared. So what happened while performing that karma? The moment ahankara identifies with that karya, that activity, the ahankara starts getting agitated. Starts getting agitated that maybe I'm not doing right, maybe I'm not doing as good as I could, maybe I should be doing something better. And after having done, there is those butterflies in the stomach. Actually, the last example that I have given, at a point blank range, they ask, Swamiji, how is it? Anything you say is a very detrimental answer. The thing was really not good, and you end up saying, "Hey, achha nahi." And they'll think, you know, this Swami, we feed them free and look at this fellow eating and still complaining, saying that, you know, that things are not good. Do you know how much effort I have put behind this? Complaining. From the stage they say, don't complain. And look at it, they complain. Forgetting that who asked the question. I'm not exaggerating, I have gone through this. That is why I said both answers are detrimental. If you end up saying it is good, it might be really good and you end up saying good. So, thoda aur khaiye na. Eat more. And if you are not being truthful, out of hesitation you said achha hai, and they end up serving more. And when Gurudev used to joke about this, saying that, you know, he's not like the Brinjal Gurudev, he's not like it. Whether he didn't like it or he made it up, doesn't matter. He used to say that what he did was he would go in and first eat that Brinjal because he didn't want to see it on his plate. People thought, "Arre, bahut pasand hai, pehle khatam kar diya." He liked it, so they serve again. He is like, you know, he says the pain didn't end there. This was in his initial days when, while eating food, he would not speak. He says after that experience, he started speaking. What happened? In a town, in those days, early days, he used to stay for 40 to 45 days. And then he would continue his Upanishad lectures in the morning and Bhagavad Gita in the evening. Or sometimes it would be both morning and evening Upanishads. Now the next bhiksha, next place where he was invited for food, that lady meets the other lady who had already served. They say, kya pasand hai unko? What does he like? I didn't know that this Swami had such a like towards this brinjal. And the next house he goes, the first thing that he opens is baigan ka chutney, baigan ka bharta, roasted baigan, different varieties of baigan. This is at the receiving end, not at the doer's end. There is so much of, you know, association with the karma, with the karya, activity, that everything can be disturbing to that ego. That disturbance in itself, that ego getting disturbed, the ego, the factor of ego itself is agha. Agha, papa. One of the names of Arjuna was anagha. Even Lord Shiva's name, one of the names is anagha. And one of the Kali's names is anagha. Akaranta strilingi, which means papa rahita, nishkalmasha, dosha varjita. These are all the other meanings of anagha. So what is the agha? Agha is the ahankara. Swamiji, how can we live in this world without agha, without ahankara? People will crush us. If you can observe that particular statement, that people will misuse us, abuse us, crush us, will be taken for granted. Who is it that is complaining? The fellow who just complained that the world will crush us, who is that entity who complained? It is our own ego which is complaining. And he says that when we do the manana of this, manana, constant reflection on what Gajendra said, it removes all the papa, all the kalmasha that is there. The main source of kalmasha is the ego. So it ends up as though what we do in the outer peripherals, good, bad, positive, negative. And sometimes, you know, when you go to, when you visit houses, on a very inappropriate place, you find a painting hanging. I didn't know why it was hanging there, but it was not going well with the entire flow of the house, or it was something, you know, strikingly speaking to you that I'm the odd man here. People are trying to sell their house. These are the tricks. There is some patch there which cannot be covered, painted or anything, so this hanging there. The same thing that we do with the makeup. Something hidden under there, right? No, Mata, don't take it seriously. It was just a joke part. After all, pata chala, sab line mein khade hain, kyun bhai? How dare you? And I don't have even an escape route out of here. If I had, I would not have said sorry. But anyway, what we do as an activity to cover up that ego, the moment there is that ego present, it is papa, it is sin. Now within that sin, good sin, bad sin, positive, negative, this is where we are. This has to be totally gone. For that purpose is what Gajendra Moksha, Gajendra Stuti has been narrated to Parikshita by Shukadevji. Now he says, Panchama, if you remember the story part of this 8th canto, we are talking of various Manu. Remember that story? The earlier Manu was the 4th Manu. Now it is the 5th Manu. In this 5th Manu's time, that the 5th Manu, his name was Raivata. And he was the brother of the earlier Manu, Tamasa, in whose time this particular Gajendra Moksha happened. Now, how come one Manu stays for that long and his own brother becomes another Manu? Maybe having reached to that stage, they had Ichha Marana Shakti, or they had that Shakti from the Lord. So this Panchama, or the 5th Raivata, or 5th Manu called Raivata, he had sons named Arjuna, Bali, Vindhya, and many more. These were the three prominent. And in that time, the Indra's name was Vibhu. Hiranyaroma, Vedashira, Urdvabahu, these were some, the three of the seven Saptarishis. So under every Manu, there are different set of Saptarishis. Now, going back, how does this Indra change and all these deities change? Understand it this way. I have explained it in the 5th canto, but I will explain it again here. That anything other than that supreme consciousness, anything to do with this entire creation, all those are jiva, like you and me, who have done lot of tapascharya and have evolved to reach to that status. Right? Now, like, there is anybody who can contest to be a president, if you are a citizen of this land, mainland, born citizen, that's right. You should be born in the mainland. So, those who are qualified then contest within those parties. If you are an independent, you can try it. And then with the public majority, one of them is selected to be the president. There's a lot of processing being done, and when you reach there, you are called, recognized as the president, the first citizen of the nation. Now, having become the president, does it mean it is a post, right? It has a tenure. But here it is, what, 4 years, right? Back in India, it is 5 years. And here, every president can have 2 terms. I think ours, the Prime Minister is the chief authority, and they can be for any number of tenures. But here it is for 2 tenures. Yeah, it is 2 tenures, right? Now, having reached to that position as a president, if somebody says, how can a president be that bad? Been such processing, evolved to become the president, how can the president be so bad? He is also a jiva who has gone to that status through various processings. Similarly, all these jivas, when they evolve, they raise to that level of Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, Indra, Varuna, Yama, Agni, Surya, Prajapati. These are all various posts that run this universe. anything other than that Supreme Consciousness. Anything that has a form and a name and a functionality is a jiva who has evolved to that status. So every generation, every creation, it is something like to understand, there are some of these shows, Broadway shows, which have been there running for ages. Can you name one of them? Which has been there for more than 30, 40 years. Mousetrap. Now the characters and the story is same. But that which was enacted the first time, the actors and actresses, do you think they continued in the 40th, 50th year later also? No, the story remained same. Even the director changed, right? The character and the presentation, everything remains same. Similarly, this entire creation, starting from Satya Yuga to the last one, Kali Yuga, you have all the avatars. You have every time this creation starts, there is Ramji, Sitaji, Krishnaji. They are all repeat. Now let me tell you another beautiful fact here. It might shock you, but understand. If they were repeat, definitely the entire story is a repeat. That means in the earlier yuga, in the earlier creation, there was the Saket. There was this story happening. It would have been different jiva. It would have been a different soul who had been to this situation. From that creation to this end, Pipilikadi Brahma Paryantam. From the smallest of the creation of this universe to the Brahma himself are just different posts. You have been given a certain post to enact that role. So understand what your role is and deliver the dialogues with good expression. That is what a good actor should do, right? And this is what even Gajendra said. In one of his stutis, one of the shlokas, that he, in the very sixth shloka, he says, Yatha natasya akriti bhir vicheshtataha. Natasya akriti, you take various forms of nataka. Now if we understand life and world from that perspective, and this is one of the logic or one of the reasonings behind creation. In and through all these various creation theories that have been proposed in and through our scriptures, don't sit comparing different theories of creation and say, how come that one Upanishad says this, and one Purana says this, and one something else says this? They don't match. These theories don't match. I think, Swamiji, our Hinduism lacks a structure. It is not systematic. Understand the purpose of why it has been introduced, then you will understand the subtlety behind. It is not to prove the creation that the theories of creation have been proposed. Normally when we think of theories of creation, whether in science or whether in the other religions, they prove the creation and the creator looking through the creation. But here, the purpose of proposing a theory of creation is not to prove the creation, but to prove and logically arrive at one single point, that this entire universe, you the consciousness, is the hub of this universe. And this entire universe is nothing but divinity. But you see multiplicity in this universe because of that layer called ego. Get rid of that ego. What you see is an ever expanding mass of consciousness alone. I shouldn't use the word ever expanding. Ever expanding, how far will it take? Again, with a concept of time and space will come. Ever existing consciousness alone is the truth. This is the purpose for which the creation theory is given. So now this Panchama Manu, in his time, there were these different Saptarishis, there was this different Indra. Remember where we started from, the connection if it is lost. Swamiji, Bhagavat bol rahe hai, kya bol rahe hai? What exactly are you trying to propose? This was the connection. And in his time, there was this Rishi whose name was Surasattama, Shubhra Rishi, whose wife's name was Vikuntha. And she gave birth to this beautiful child who was none other than the Lord himself, and this avatar was called Vaikuntha. And he was the one who created a special place for Lakshmiji in Vaikuntha. That is why that entire place, his dhama, his abode is called Vaikuntha. What is Ramji's abode called? You're sitting in it. It is Saket. That's why it's called Saket Rama. That is his abode. What is Vishnu's abode? Come on, I just said Vaikuntha. What are these different abodes? What do you mean by it? It is like a huge building called Swarga. And that building has various floors. Now each floor is one loka. One is called Kailasha, one is called Goloka, the other one is called Vaikuntha. If you are going into Devi Upasana, it is called Shri Loka. Then there is Brahma Loka. So these are all various lokas. Swamiji, do they exist? Because if Swarga and these lokas are real, then Naraka and those lokas also should be real, right? So do they really exist? Gurudev, in his question answers in one of the books, he very beautifully answers. If you, the questioner, thinks that the questioner and the questioning is real, then yes, there is Swarga and Naraka. But if you understand that this multiplicity is not real, you have transcended, then for such one, there is no Naraka, there is no Swarga. Now, let us understand this in a simple format. Swamiji, to understand transcending, and it is so abstract. There is somebody who does a good job, maybe your yard work or house cleaning, painting, something. And when you give the reward, whatever is the pay you have given, but on extra, because you really like the way they worked, you give extra. So it goes to that person. Similarly, when somebody does bad, and that person who has done something bad, the law is looking for them. The cops are looking for them. So there has been a warrant issued. Catch that fellow. So they have surrounded that place. They have been waiting for that moment. They have surrounded that place, covered all entry exits, and they crash in. They really break through the doors and enter. And when they entered, they found that fellow dead. The fellow who has to be arrested and taken to the court is already dead. Now what happens to that warrant? Just because the warrant has already been issued, anybody bystander standing there, they catch them and say, "Usko bana ke, can you take the other fellow?" No. The same way, the reward that you are supposed to give, if that person dies, the person is non-existent anymore. Dying means that. That's what I mean. The person itself is non-existent anymore. Either the reward or the punishment, can it be given to that person anymore? Similarly, the result of this reward or punishment, which is swarga or naraka, when the person, the ego itself is non-existent, would that be existent? Does it make sense? So he was the one who created that special place for Lakshmi Devi in Vaikuntha. So that is why that place is still recognized as Vishnu's abode, meaning Vaikuntha. Now after the fifth one, then the sixth one. The sixth one was, his name was Chakshusha. And the Manvantara was called Chakshusha Manvantara. And this Chakshusha Manu had many sons, of whom three were the most important: Puru, Purusha and Sudyumna. Now these names, it might seem very incoherent. Swamiji, why are you telling us these names? When you read other Puranas, when you read Mahabharata and other places, these are the names which get reflected. That particular sixth Manu's third son. How do we know who is that son? Right? So when you go through this, it gives you a completeness that it is connecting some other missing string somewhere else. So you know, pay attention to it. Remember it is not his grace. But pay attention to it. So this sixth Manu, in his time, the Indra was Mantradruma, he became the Indra. And then the Saptarishis were Havishman, Viraka, these were the Saptarishis. And in this time is when the Kurma Avatara took place. And the beautiful incident that the Lord took simultaneously multiple avatars. He became Kurma. He became the one who would control the Mantarachal mountain from the top so that it could be applied with pressure. He was the one who became the distributor of the nectar. You know, when people suddenly start into this Hinduism and start reading through, one of the doubts that normally comes up with regards to Ramayana is, Swamiji, you say that Parashurama is an avatar of the Lord and Rama is also avatar of the Lord. How can he be there in the same yuga at the same time? They both come and they both have a chat with each other. How come it is the same Lord with two avatars at the same time? My simple answer is, it is his world. Why do you have a problem? If a director directing a movie casts the same person twice, double role. Why did, how can there be double role? Marji hai. Uski marji. Similarly, he is the world's universe director. So he can come at any time, if he deems it appropriate. Now in this Manvantara, he comes as Kurma Avatara. Now when you look at the sequence of the avatars, it is not with the same sequence that we learn the 10 important avatars: Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Narasimha, Vamana, that they have happened in this sequence. No. They have happened in various different sequences. Of all these various avatars, the 10 most important avatars are these. In the very first canto, we have covered 42 avatars, if you remember. Of those 42 avatars, the 10 are the ones that we usually talk about a lot. If there is an actor, and there are plenty of movies released, would you end up remembering all of those movies? Which ones would you remember? The best ones, the hit movies, the blockbusters is what you remember. The Silver Jubilee ones, the ones which have crossed 100 days. You remember those, not all of them. Similarly, in the Lord, there are some which in which he was just an amsha avatar. Just a little part of him just approached into this world to rectify. The full energy of his was not required in that moment. Like, you know your child is misbehaving. What amount of energy is required to control that child at that moment, you know. A glance. A glance turning into a glare. Like, you see it and the child silent. And it still doesn't. The glance becomes a glare. A gesture. Or you finally going there and said, do it again, I'm going to see. That is called Purna Avatar. The glance was Amsha Avatar. The glare was in between the Amsha Avatara and the Purna Avatara. Now you understood, right? Similarly, the Lord, in order to maintain the balance in this creation, comes in various forms. So that Lord comes at the same time in various avatars. So Parikshit says, that many avatars of the Lord? See, Parikshit, if you have observed, it's the same like you all. This Manu, he had this many sons, this was Indra, this was a Deva, this was a Saptarishi. You know what was that? It was like trying to stifle the yawning. Swamiji, these are names. It doesn't tune into us. At the moment he got a chance to hear about the Lord and his glories, he says, can you explain that part in detail? So it is like Shukadevji also knows that this is the most interesting part. And that is why he approached the entire thing saying, that this was the Manu's time wherein this thing had happened. And he was eagerly waiting to see Parikshit ji ask that question with that, you know, glow in his eyes. The moment he heard this, Shukadevji says, I was also, see here, the beauty is both the speaker and the listener loves listening about, talking about the Lord. And they need just a reason to think and talk about their beloved Lord. So yeah, they gave that information about Manvantara and all these Manus. But then when he stopped, paused there, waiting as though for Parikshit to ask questions, Shukadevji is also happy. Now I am also interested in telling about that in detail. So Shukadevji, with a smile on his face, says, that, hey Parikshit, long ago, this comes in the 15th shloka of the 5th chapter. Long ago, the asuras started gaining lot of strength under their able king, Bali. And so powerful was he, so righteous was he, unlike any other asura. The other asuras were not righteous, and they were very harmful, detrimental. But then this Bali was somebody who had principles better than the earlier ones. he was so powerful that he shook the entire devas out of swarga. All three worlds were ruled by Bali. Saddened by their situation, that they would not get their yajna shesha, they would not be offered anything because they were not in the ruling party. So they didn't have their income coming. So what did this god do, gods do? They were so sad, they all went to Brahmaji. Said, "Oh creator, you have created such beautiful world, but these daityas have become so powerful under Bali that we have nowhere to stay, nothing to eat, we have not been having our minimum resources. Tell us, why has this end come to us?" The same thing that we say. Why me? The god, these Indra, the Devatas, they were also like, why us? So Brahmaji said, "Listen, I can only talk about the creation aspect. You have asked with a different department. You have come to a wrong department. You should go to the maintenance department. I deal only with the creation department. But I can do one thing, is that I can help you, I can join you all, pray for that Vishnu, so that he would give us darshan and show us a solution." So Brahmaji now takes the lead role in trying to convince Vishnuji to give an darshan. Now as soon as Brahmaji's description of Lord and his greatness, his stuti is done, Brahma stuti, the Lord comes down and shows them a darshana, beautiful form. Now when he is looking, he knows why these devas have come. The purpose is very clear. But then, not to misunderstand, not to take them for granted, he wanted them to come out with their request. So the Lord said, "What exactly is your problem? Why have you invoked me? Why do you need my presence here? And it seems like all devas are together here. And you all are working, or you all seem to be in one unit, one team." This is what Lord says. Usually you have your internal teams, but today you seem to be all in one team. What is so, this is something strange. What has brought you all together? Because in apatti kala, when we are in trouble, we forget all our personal differences, little tiny differences, and we all come together. When everything, every quotient in our life is well settled, then the small little differences become big ones. Don't you see that? There was this great Mahatma ji. I have not met him in long many years. So he used to say, whenever in his ashram, his brahmacharis would come with small little complaints against each other, he would say, "From tomorrow, there is no achar with your khichdi." And they would like, "No pickle with your khichdi." And these were like, "What a solution is that? He did something to me and I am complaining, and you say no achar for everybody?" So he would say it in such a beautiful way, "Tum logon ko charbi bahut badh gayi hai." How do I translate that into English? Fact toh main bhi janta hun. That will be true translation. You have become so dense that you are not able to see the complete picture. Small tiny little things become so big a deal for you. And when it is real trouble time, all these small little differences, they vanish in thin air. There is no more such differences. Now when you look at back in India also, 1947 we got independence. Till then everybody was like together, independence, independence. There was such a huge movement. After we got independence, nobody in that forefront thought what would we do after independence. There was no plan. They knew that they wanted independence. And this again, not out of the audacity that, you know, I know more or I could have done more. It is only with the hindsight. Everything looks perfect that it would have been done in a different way. But there was no vision after that. So soon after independence, what happened? Right from the leaders to the led, everybody became self-centered. How would I survive out of this slavery that we have come? How would I bring in my print into this world? Till then, all those small little differences were always, you know, washed away. This is something beautiful that I am seeing in you all, that you have all come together. Then these devas said, Lord, not that you don't know, but you know, we are in a troubled times, troubled situations. We seek your help and blessings. So the Lord says, I know why you have come. I know what exactly is going through your minds. Hanta Brahman Aho Shambho He Deva Mama Bhashitam Shrunutavahita Sarve Shreyo Vasyad Yatha Suraha. He says, I understand you Suraha, all you gods have been displaced of your position and you are feeling very insecure. So what do we have to do? He says, the Kshira Sagara, the Milky Oceans, has a lot of treasure in it. And the most divine treasure that it holds is called Amrita, in that Amrita Kalasha. When we churn that Milky Ocean, the Amrita will be given out by that Milky Ocean. And when you drink that Amrita, then you become Amara. Unchallenged by anybody. So Deva said, this is a good plan. But Lord, the entire world, three worlds are being ruled by them. What if they, you know, oppose us? What if they start creating hindrances? So Lord says, here it is called Rajaniti. A very beautiful lesson of Rajaniti being given here. The Lord says, Arayopi hi sandheyaha satikar yarthagaurave ahimushika vaddevaha hi arthasya padavim gataihi. He says, apply the ahimushaka nyaya. What is this ahimushaka nyaya? Ahi means a serpent, a snake. Mushaka is a mouse. So what happened that this snake charmer had the snake in his box, you know, that bamboo box that he would tap and then play and it would come out. So this snake was bound in that. Somehow by mistake a rat landed into that box, wooden box. The snake immediately thought, after a long time I have something good to eat. But then he said, this is rat. The snake said, you know, can we be friends? The rat was like, what? I don't trust you. I don't believe you. Why should I be your friends? The snake said, you are also trapped. I am also trapped. You have the strength to make a hole into this so that you also can escape. I also can escape. The rat also was convinced. So rat made a hole. And the snake made a wholesome meal and then left out of the hole. So the Lord says, Ahimushakavad Devaha, He Deva, use that Ahimushaka Nyaya. I know they are not trustworthy. They could pull the fast one and they could deceit you at any time. But then, when you know that there will be more of a harm, when you don't inform them, see, sometimes running such big institutions and organizations, especially this becomes quite important task when you are running a voluntary organization. If it were other organization, even Guruji says, if it were a paid organization, I wish I could have fired many of you long time ago. But then in a voluntary organization, what happens? There are some people who know how to work. There are some people who know how to work when told. There are some people who don't work even when told. So we end up thinking that, you know, it is not, you know, they don't even do. So let us avoid them and continue. If you don't inform them, they become a nuisance value. So that is where this nyaya can be applied. See, inform them and be prepared to get that job done by 10 others. This is one category. There are other category. They jump into the action saying, I need to be doing something. Give me some work. Okay, one job given, they miss. Second job you give, third they miss. So you understand that anything given to them is a messy thing. If you don't give them a job, they'll create such a hullabaloo that they've been ignored, they have been done this, they've been done that. So instead of attending to that nuisance value, give them a work and also train 5-6 others who can keep correcting whatever they have done and yet attribute the goodness of it to them and keep moving forward. There are many such situations. So here he says, Deva, all O gods, it is good if you can befriend all these daityas, asuras. Go attend the committee meetings and board meetings and bring all of them together. Now Indra was personally trained by the Lord how to approach on these topics. Now this Indra approached Bali, and the moment all these asuras saw that Bali, in the kingdom of Bali, all the devas without their weapons were walking in, they said, this is the right time to finish them all. So Bali said, wait, nobody is an enemy forever. It is based on the situation we come to derive who is an enemy and who is a friend. But let's understand, why have they ventured without even their weapons? So they have come to talk. So let's first hear them out. So these devas, Indra especially, comes to Bali. They says, hey Raja. Now earlier it seems, Indra used to call for these daityas. Come to Swarga, I need to talk to you people. And they would go there and do the stuti of Indra and they stand there in line for their turn and then have their things said. Now it was the other way around. And Bali allowed them to speak. Indra is such a smooth talker. And they said, His words were soaked in honey. And what was his convincing point? He said, that cannot be churned, that milky ocean cannot be churned with this mantra chala, you know, that has to be moved into that ocean and it has to be churned. The devas cannot do it. So what we will do is, we both will put an effort and then divide whatever comes between us. I said, okay, seems to be a fine deal. So there was the Devas round table conference, Asuras round table conference. Each one of them brought out their memorandum of understanding. Then finally their lawyers and these lawyers met to see the finer print. And then finally Bali and Indra sat down and signed the papers that yes, we both will put the effort. And both of them, with all their strength, all of their capacities, moved to Mantharachal mountain, requested, prayed to that mountain to help them. And the mountain said, okay, I'll come there to help you. What is in it for me? And it knows that, you know, it is the Amrita. The deal is, you give me some percentage of it. I said, okay, granted. And then they went to Vasuki. Who is Vasuki? He is a snake who is on the, what do you call this? Pinky. Kanishtika. So on this pinky, on Lord Shiva's pinky, it is the ring. So they requested Vasuki, we need the rope that can go around the Mantharachala. Can you increase your size and be a part of it? I said, yes, I am ready, but I need to also get a share from that. I said, okay, given. So both the Rakshasas and the Devas have to understand, come to an understanding as to how much percentage to be given with to everybody who has been included. And then finally they started moving Mantharachal mountain. It was such a huge mountain that in the initial time, in the beginning, the Devas were trying to outbeat the Asuras, trying to show their strength. And the Asuras were not any less. They also wanted to outbeat these Devas. So they would also put all of their energy, showing their muscles. After that initial enthusiasm, the Mantharachal mountain was so heavy that after a while they did not have that sufficient energy, both. And even before they could realize, the entire mountain fell on them. There were many Devas, many Asuras who were crushed underneath. And the beautiful way they say is, some of them lost hands, some of them lost legs, some of them lost limbs, but most of them lost the spirit itself. I said, and we can't even move this from here to the ocean, forget about, you know, churning it into that milky ocean. This is not possible. So they had second round of round table conference. Whether it was in Warsaw or Geneva, I don't know. They had a second round table conference. And as they were trying to then think whether it is really a good idea to go for it or not, then the Lord himself appeared on his Garuda. And with his Karuna Drishti, the entire army of Asuras and Devas, those who had lost their limbs, those who had painful misery, crushed, everybody was rejuvenated. And what did the Lord do? The Lord himself picked that Mantharachal and put on the Garuda. And along with this Devas and Asuras, moved that Mantharachal to the Kshira Sagar, the milky ocean. And then Vasuki was requested, can you go around Yes. And Lord said to the Devas, you go to that end of the mouth. And the Asuras, this is not fair. The three worlds are now under us. We are the actual kings. We should get the right to choose. Why? The tail of the snake is the Ashubha Anga. We don't want to hold the tail of a snake. We want to hold the other side. So Lord looked at the gods and said, shift. So the Asuras went on that side. The Devas came to this side, holding the tail now, and they started churning. It is as though that the Lord winked at these gods, Indradi Devata, saying, good, you got the tail. So, why tail? I said, the next yajna, the Lord said, he would give the detail. Because they had brought in that Mantarachala. Now they were trying to find how do they plan to move that, churn that Milky Ocean with the help of the Mantarachala. So it would take another few weeks for them to come up with a plan. Then we will continue with the Kshirasagara Mathana. And this Kshirasagara Mathana is the most practical, applicable spiritual sadhana that has been very beautifully portrayed in Bhagavatam. And what do you mean by spiritual sadhana? Every step of this story, we have something subtle, beautiful to learn. It's such a beautiful part of that story. So that we will do whenever, Lord willing, we get the next opportunity. Shri Krishna, Shri Krishna. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. If you can get a tray or something so that they can offer the Guru Dakshina. This time, since we had Gajendra Moksha, did lot of research to get this particular beautiful photograph of the Lord trying to save Gajendra. So come and take that as a prasada, as you come and offer. There will be fruits also. So please do come and have prasada for your body and prasada for your mind.